Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Karina. Thank you so much. Good afternoon. Very welcome, all of you. I appreciate a lot your presence here. Because people always say that poetry doesn't work. But in my case, it did. But I want to talk about two persons already gone, without who I wouldn't be able to be reading these poems. First of all, with my editor and publisher, Robert Christman, from the Black Scholar Press, who published the very first anthology of my poems, bilingual, translated by Kathleen Weaver. And then many other people, but among researchers and people who studied Cuba and the Caribbean, I want to thank the memory and talk about the memory of Helen Safat, who passed away. And this is it. How many poets like Jane Cortez, who passed away. She was a sister. But I wanted you to know that there will be some of my books, especially Looking Within, that was published by the University of Michigan in Detroit some years ago. I appreciate the efforts of Melba Boyd, who did a great effort and job in the press. And of course, I appreciate the presence of Chelsea, who is going to read the English translations of these poems. Oh, as I always say, when I started reading, I always remember thinking by Virginia Woolf, who said that behind every female writer, every female poet, there is the shadow, the ghost of another. Madre. Mi madre no tuvo jardín, sino islas acantiladas flotando bajo el sol en sus corales delicados. No hubo una rama limpia en su pupila, sino muchos garrotes. Qué tiempo aquel cuando corría descalza sobre la cal de los orfeminatos y no sabía reír y no podía siquiera mirar el horizonte. Ella no tuvo el aposento de marfil, ni la sala de mimbre, ni el vitral silencioso del trópico. Mi madre tuvo el canto y el pañuelo para acunar la fe de mis entrañas, para alzar su cabeza de reina desoída y dejarnos sus manos como piedras preciosas frente a los restos fríos del enemigo.
Translated by Heather Rosario Cire. Mother. My mother had no garden, but rather steep islands floating beneath the sun on their delicate corals. She had no clean branch in her eye, but many garrotes. When a time that was when she ran barefoot on the limestone of the orphanages, and she did not know how to laugh, and she could not even gaze at the horizon. She had no ivory chamber, nor a wicker parlor, nor the silent stained glass of the tropics. My mother had the song and the handkerchief to cradle my heart's faith, to lift her head of a queen ignored, and to leave us her hands, like precious stones, before the cold remains of the enemy.
El tambor. Mi cuerpo convoca la llama. Mi cuerpo convoca los humos, mi cuerpo en el desastre como un pájaro blando, mi cuerpo como islas, mi cuerpo junto a las catedrales, mi cuerpo en el coral, aires los de mi bruma, fuego sobre mis aguas, aguas irreversibles en los azules de la tierra, mi cuerpo en plenilunio, mi cuerpo como las codornices, mi cuerpo en una pluma, mi cuerpo al sacrificio, mi cuerpo en la penumbra, mi cuerpo en claridad, mi cuerpo ingrávido en la luz vuestra, libre en el arco.
Translated by David Fry and Nancy Abraham Ball. The drum. My body summons the flame. My body summons the smoke. My body in disaster like a gentle bird. My body like islands. My body beside the cathedrals. My body up in the coral. The breezes of my sea mist, fire upon my waters, waters irreversible in the blues of the earth. My body in full moon, my body like the quails, my body on a feather, my body to sacrifice, my body in shadows, my body in full sun, my body weightless in the light, your light, free in the art.
Los ojos de lengua. Esta noche, junto a las puertas del caserón rojizo, he vuelto a ver los ojos del guerrero Eleguá, la lengua roja de sangre como el corazón de los hierros, los pies dorados, desiguales, la tez de fuego, el pecho encabritado y sonriente. Acaba de estallar en gritos, Eleguá salta, imagina los cantos, roza el espacio como un puñal de cobre. ¿Quién le consentirá si no es la piedra o el coco blanco? ¿Quién recogerá los caracoles de sus ojos? Ya no sabrá de Olofi si ha perdido el camino. Ya no sabrá de los rituales, ni de los animales en su honor, ni de la lanza mágica, ni de los silbidos en la noche. Si los ojos de Legua regresaran, volverían a atravesar el río pujante donde los dioses se alejaban, donde existían los peces. ¿Quién sabrá entonces del cantar de los pájaros? El gran Eleguá ata mis manos y las abre y ya huye. Y bajo la yagruma está el secreto, las cabezas, el sol y lo que silba, como único poder del oscuro camino.
Translated by David Fry, The Eyes of Eleguá. Tonight, by the doors of the big old reddish house, once more I have seen the warrior's eyes, Eleguá, tongue, blood red like the hearts of iron tools, feet tanned, uneven skin, fiery chest, rearing, smiling. He has just burst out shouting. Eleguá jumps, imagines the hymns, rubs space with a copper knife. Who will let him, if not the stone or the white coconut? Who will recover the seashells of his eyes? He wouldn't know if Olofi has lost the trail, wouldn't remember the rituals, nor the animals in his honor, nor the magic lance, nor the whistling in the night. If the eyes of Eleguá would come back, they would cross the raging river once again, where the gods went away, where the fish once swam. Who would remember when the songs of birds, the great Eleguá has tied my hands and loosens them and runs away, and under the yagruma lies the secret, the heads, the sun, and the thing that whistles, the only force on that dark path.
Negro, tu pelo para algunos era diablura del infierno, pero el zunzún allí puso su nido sin reparos cuando pendías en lo alto del horcón frente al palacio de los capitanes. Dijeron sí que el polvo del camino te hizo infiel y violáceo como esas flores invernales del trópico, siempre tan asombrosas y arrogantes. Ya moribundo sospechan que tu sonrisa era salobre y tu musgo impalpable para el encuentro del amor. Otros afirman que tus palos de monte nos trajeron ese daño sombrío que no nos deja relucir ante Europa y que nos lanza en la vorágine ritual a ese ritmo imposible de los tambores innombrables. Nosotros amaremos por siempre tus huellas y tu ánimo de bronce, porque has traído esa luz viva del pasado fluyente, ese dolor de haber entrado limpio a la batalla, ese afecto sencillo por las campanas y los ríos, ese rumor de aliento libre en primavera que corre al mar para volver y volver a partir.
Translated by Gabrielle Abudu. Black men. Your hair, for some, was the devil's work from hell, but the hummingbird built its nest there, unheeding, when you were hanging at the end of the gallows in front of the Governor General's palace. They did say that the dust of the road made you disloyal and purplish, like those winter flowers from the tropics, always so startling and arrogant. Now that you are dying, they suspect that your smile was brinish and your moss beyond the touch of love. Others say that your religious spirits brought on us that gloomy damnation which does not let us shine in the eyes of Europe and which thrusts us in the ritual whirlwind into that impossible rhythm of that unnameable drums. We shall always love your footprints and your spirit of bronze, for you have brought the bright light from the fluid past, that pain of having entered clean into battle, that simple love for bells and rivers, that rumor of free breath in spring that runs to the sea to return and leave again.
Amo a mi amo. Amo a mi amo. Recojo leña para encender su fuego cotidiano. Amo sus ojos claros, mansa cual un cordero, esparzo gotas de miel por sus orejas. Amo sus manos que me depositaron sobre un lecho de hierbas. Mi amo muerde y subyuga, me cuenta historias sigilosas mientras abanico todo su cuerpo cundido de llagas y balazos de días de sol y guerra de rapiña. Amo sus pies que piratearon y rodaron por tierras ajenas. Los froto con los polvos más finos que encontré una mañana saliendo de la vega. Tañó la vihuela y de su garganta salían coplas sonoras como nacidas de la garganta de Manrique. Yo quería haber oído una marímbula sonar. Amo su boca roja, fina, desde donde van saliendo palabras que no alcanzo a descifrar todavía. Mi lengua para él ya no es la suya, y la seda del tiempo echa trizas. Oyendo hablar a los viejos guardieros, supe que mi amor da latigazos en las calderas del ingenio, como si fuera un infierno, el de aquel Señor Dios de quien me hablaba sin cesar. ¿Qué me dirá? ¿Por qué vivo en la morada ideal para un murciélago? ¿Por qué le sirvo? ¿A dónde va en su espléndido coche, tirado por caballos más felices que yo? Mi amor es como la maleza que cubre la dotación, única posesión inexpugnable mía. Maldigo esta bata de muselina que me ha impuesto, estos encajes vanos que despiadado mendigó, estos quehaceres para mí en el atardecer sin girasoles, esta lengua abigarradamente hostil que no mastico, estos senos de piedra que no pueden siquiera amamantarlo, este vientre rajado por su látigo inmemorial, este maldito corazón. Amo a mi amo, pero todas las noches, cuando atravieso la vereda florida hacia el cañaveral, donde a hurtadillas hemos hecho el amor, me veo cuchillo en mano, desollándole como a una res sin culpa, Ensordecedores toques de tambor ya no me dejan oír ni sus quebrantos ni sus quejas. Las campanas me llaman.
Translated by Kathleen Weaver. I love my master. I love my master. I gather firewood to light his daily fire. I love his clear eyes, tame as any lamb. I scatter drops of honey on his ears. I love his hands, which laid me down on a bed of grass. My master bites, subjugates. He tells me secret stories while I fan his whole body full of sores and bullet wounds, of days in the sun and plunderous war. I love his feet, which buccaneered and wandered around in foreign lands. I massage them with the finest powders, which I found one morning while leaving the tobacco field. He strummed his guitar, and from his throat came sonorous verses, as if born from the throat of Manrique. I wish I had heard a marimbula play. I love his delicate red mouth, from which spill words that I cannot quite decipher yet. My tongue for him is no longer his own. And the silk of time in tatters. Hearing the old field guards talking, I learned that my love gives lashings in the cauldrons of the sugar mill, steaming like some hell, the hell of that Lord God he used to talk to me about unendingly. What could he tell me? Why am I living in a lodging perfect for a bat? Why must I serve him? Where could he go in his splendid carriage, drawn by horses happier than I? My love is like the weeds that cover the dowry, the only possession he cannot take from me. I curse this muslin robe he has imposed on me, these vain lace dresses he forced on me without pity, these chores of mine in the sunflowerless afternoon, this baroquely hostile tongue I can't get between my teeth, these stone breasts that can't even suckle him, this womb raked by his immemorial lashings, this accursed heart. I love my master, but every night when I cross the flowery pathway to the cane fields where we have surreptitiously made love, I can see myself with knife in hand, butchering him like innocent cattle. Deafening drumbeats no longer let me hear neither his sorrows nor his complaints. The tolling bells call me.
Mujer negra, todavía huelo la espuma del mar que me hicieron atravesar. La noche, no puedo recordarla, ni el mismo océano podría recordarla. Pero no olvido el primer alcatraz que divisé. Altas las nubes, como inocentes testigos presenciales. ¿Acaso no he olvidado ni mi costa perdida, ni mi lengua ancestral? Me dejaron aquí y aquí he vivido, y porque trabajé como una bestia, aquí volví a nacer. ¿A cuánta epopeya mandinga intenté recurrir? Me rebelé, su merced me compró en una plaza, bordé la casaca de su merced y un hijo macho le parí. Mi hijo no tuvo nombre y su merced murió a manos de un impecable lord inglés. Anduve. Esta es la tierra donde padecí bocabajos y azotes. Bogué a lo largo de todos sus ríos. Bajo su sol sembré, recolecté, y las cosechas no comí. Por casa tuve un barracón. Yo misma traje piedras para edificarlo, pero canté al natural compás de los pájaros nacionales. Me sublevé. En esta misma tierra toqué la sangre húmeda y los huesos podridos de muchos otros, traídos a ella o no, igual que yo. Ya nunca más imaginé el camino a Guinea. Era Guinea, a Benín, era Madagascar o a Cabo Verde. Trabajé mucho más, fundé mejor mi canto milenario y mi esperanza. Aquí construí mi mundo. Me fui al monte. Mi real independencia fue el palenque y cabalgué entre las tropas de Maceo. Solo un siglo más tarde, junto a mis descendientes, desde una azul montaña, bajé de la sierra para acabar con capitanes y usureros, con generales y burgueses. Ahora soy, solo hoy tenemos y creamos. Nada nos es ajeno, nuestra la tierra, nuestros el mar y el cielo, nuestras la magia y la quimera. Iguales míos, aquí los veo bailar alrededor del árbol que plantamos para el comunismo. Su pródiga madera ya resuena.
Translated by Kathleen Weaver. Black woman. I still smell the foam of the sea they made me cross. The night, I can't remember it. The ocean itself could not remember that. But I can't forget the first gull I made out in the distance. High, the clouds, like innocent eyewitnesses. Perhaps I haven't forgotten my lost coast or my ancestral language. They left me here, and here I've lived. And because I worked like an animal, here I was reborn. How many mandiga epics did I look to for strength? I rebelled. His worship brought me and bought me in a public square. I embroidered his worship's coat and bore him a male child. My son had no name, and his worship died at the hands of an impeccable English lord. I walked. This is the land where I suffered mouth in the dust and the lash. I rode the length of all its rivers. Under its sun, I planted seeds, brought in the crops, but never ate those harvests. A slave barracks was my house, built with stones that I hauled myself while I sang to the pure beat of native birds. I rose up. In this same land, I touched the fresh blood and decayed bones of many others, brought to this land or not, the same as I. I no longer dreamt of the road to Guinea. Was it to Guinea, Benin, to Madagascar, or Cape Verde? I worked on and on. I strengthened the foundations of my millenary song and of my hope. Here I built my world. I left for the hills. My real independence was the free slave fort, and I rode with the troops of Mexico.
Maceo,
sorry. Only a century later, together with my descendants from a blue mountain, I came down from the Sierra to put an end to capital and usurer, to generals and to bourgeois. Now I exist, only today do we own, do we create. Nothing is foreign to us. The land is ours, ours the sea and the sky, the magic and the vision. My equals, here I see you dance around the tree we are planting for communism, its prodigal wood resounds.
Manto. Oh, las palabras formando un manto a mi alrededor. La pureza de sus sonidos anda corriendo sobre mi funda de bambula. Todas las palabras sonando sobre el lago de un país de África del Sur. Cuántas palabras entretejidas que no necesito ver, sino escuchar como estrujadas a una vez en el fondo de los océanos, hasta que un delfín asoma su cola triunfal en el centro de las madréporas y un canto de sirena va empujando su nariz rosa hasta la punta de una luna, esa luna que las palabras van tejiendo con una hebra de plata que tiene como fondo el ardor de las algas ondeantes, una hebra de plata que se agiganta como en la música de mi vecino José Claro Fumero y se transforma en un precioso manto tibio para mi bien.
Cloak. Oh, the words forming a cloak all around me. Their pierced sounds are pouring over my gauze pillowcase. Oh, the words ringing out over the lake in a country in southern Africa. So many words woven together that I don't need to see, just hear as they're crushed all at once on the bottoms of the ocean. Until a dolphin flashes its triumphant tail in the midst of the stony coral, and a siren's song pushes its pink nose all the way up to the tip of the moon. That moon, the song's words stitched together with thread of silver, that has at its core the ardor of swaying seaweed, a thread of silver that grows and grows, like the music of my neighbor, Jose Claro Fumero, and becomes a lovely, warm cloak to comfort me.
Cotorra que atraviesa Manrique, a Chiqui Salsa Mende. De súbito, una cotorra mínima va a desplazar su pico por la calle Manrique y la despavorida ronronea dando palos de ciego, tal vez buscando algún destino. Los verdes y los azules de su cuello estallan frente a las zanahorias, el berro y las lechugas. Dos negras se aproximan desde la multitud en un vaivén de hamacas vivas columpiadas por el viento del golfo. Un vendedor de periódicos apenas puede pregonar, absorto ante el fulgor de la cotorra y la belleza natural de las negras. La calle Manrique es un boceto del andaluce y se detuvo el vendedor como alguien que acaba de descubrir todo un zoológico.
Translated by Gabriel Alburin. Parrot, por Chiqui Salsa Mende. Suddenly, a tiny parrot sets off wiggling its beak along Manrique Street, and the terrified parrot purrs, fluttering about wildly, perhaps looking for some destination. The green and blue colors of its neck brighten up at the sight of the carrots, the watercress, and the lettuce. From among the crowd, two black women approach, swaying like living hammocks, rocked by the winds of the gulf. A newspaper vendor, struck by the splendor of the parrot and the natural beauty of the black women, can barely hawk his wares. Manrique Street is a sketch of Andalusia, and the newspaper seller stopped, like one who has just discovered an entire zoo.
Monólogo del pescador. De niño, yo siempre soñaba con peces. Que venía un chicherecú y me los arrancaba de la mano después que tanto trabajo me había costado llegar al fondo mismo del río, llenito de piedras, allá en la desembocadura que iba a parar a la mar. Todo el mundo decía, pez de agua dulce se va entre las manos. El pez de agua dulce se escurre como el conejo en el monte y deja una línea fosforescente que nunca se te olvida. Cómo quise coger viajaibas y nunca lo conseguí. No me importaba si eran de mar, si eran de río. Yo quería pescar peces, sacarlos del agua con mis propias manos mientras iba nadando. Y en el camino de la orilla a mi casa, hablarles de mil cosas que me contaran ellos las travesuras de los chicherecú. Cosas de muchacho. Y ya ustedes ven, al final, creo que mi sueño se ha cumplido.
Translated by Pam Carmel. Fisherman's Monologue. As a boy, I always dreamed about fish, about how chicherecú, goblin, the one in the old stories, would come and snatch them out of my hand after I'd worked so hard to get all the way to the bottom of the river, completely covered with rocks, there at the mouth of the river that opened to the sea. Everyone said, freshwater fish slips out of your hands. Freshwater fish dart away like rabbits in the brush and leave a phosphorescent trail you never forget. How I tried to catch red-tailed beahaiba fish, but never managed it. I didn't care if they were from the ocean, if they were from the river. I wanted to catch fish, pull them out of the water with my own hands as I swam along, and on the road from the shore to my home, talk to them about a thousand things, Get them to tell me about the pranks the chichiricus pull. Just a boy's foolish ideas. And now, as you can all see, in the end, I think my dream has come true.
The next two poems, the poems don't need explanation, but anyway, sometimes you have to make some remarks and so forth. These two poems are dedicated to two women, two very important Cuban women. Nieves Fresneda, who passed away in 1991, and Alicia Alonso. My perspective is that Nieves restores all the magic of Afro-Cuban culture. She is the earth, our land. And Alicia Alonso is, on the contrary, the air, the wind, the other side of Cuban culture. But anything comes through the dance. Dance for us is very important. Many poets and writers in the Caribbean, they believe that dance is the most universal and extended expression of the Caribbean, the most popular, anonymous or not. Dance, you don't have to speak, because even now I am speaking in English. When you dance, you only need the music, but dancing it. You don't need translation. You don't need it. It's the most powerful and naive of our expressions. And Nieves Fresneda, she died in 1981. She was the most beautiful and marvelous, splendid dancers of Cuban, Afro-Cuban folklore. Her dance for Yemaya was praised and was very well known all over the world. Elogio de Nieves Fresneda. Como un pez volador, Nieves Fresneda. Olas de mar, galeotes, azules pétalos de algas cubren sus días y sus horas, renaciendo a sus pies. Rumor de Benín la trajo al fondo de esta tierra. Allí están sus culebras, sus círculos, sus cauris, sus sayas, sus pies buscando la manigua, abriendo rutas desconocidas hacia el loco. Sus pies marítimos, al fin, troncos de sal, perpetuos pies de nieves, alzados como lunas para Yemayá. Y en el espacio luego, entre la espuma, nieves, girando sobre el mar, nieves, por entre el canto inmemorial del sueño, nieves, en los mares de Cuba, nieves.
Translated by David Fry, in praise of Nieves Fresneda. Like a flying fish, Nieves Fresneda. Ocean waves, galley slaves, blue petals of seaweed cover her days and hours, are reborn at her feet. A murmur of Benin carried her to the depths of this land. There are her snakes, her circles, her cowries, her skirts, her feet, in search of the swamp, opening unknown routes toward Olokun. Her maritime feet, after all, chunks of salt, everlasting feet of Nieves, uplifted like moons for Yemaya. And in space afterward, amid the foam, Nieves, spinning upon the sea, Nieves amidst the immemorial song of dreams, Nieves on the seas of Cuba, Nieves.
Alicia Alonso, asida entre la luz y el mundo, leve y profunda, se adelanta la cabeza gentil de Alicia Alonso. Qué sinsonte a sus pies, qué murmullo del pino. Soñando junto al tiempo aclarado y feliz, se adelanta su sombra como un suave noviembre, como un suave noviembre después. Aparecen los hilos de la lluvia y Alicia gira y gira con aliento de brisna tal vez. He aquí su espacio eterno. Vamos, silencio. Ella baila entre el don y la espuma, entre la flor y el mito, en el misterio, entre el mito y la flor, en el misterio.
Translated by David Fry and Nancy A. Hall. Alicia Alonso. Held tight between light and the world, slight and profound, here comes the gentle head of Alicia Alonso. What a mockingbird at her feet, what a murmuring of pine, dreaming alongside a clarified happy time, her shadow comes forward like a sweet November thereafter. The lines of rain appear, and Alicia spins and spins with the breath of the breeze, perhaps. This, here, is her eternal space. Let's go. Silence. She dances between the gift and the foam, between the flower and the myth, in the mystery, between the myth and the flower, in the mystery.
I think you may know the name of Wilfredo Lam, a great Cuban painter. He had in his blood no European blood, but Chinese and African. Because when slaves came, or were brought by violence manners to our island, this was a great political discussion between Spain and France and Great Britain. So Great Britain was very powerful, and they started to make hostage to the trade of slaves, not exactly the slavery, but the trade of slaves. And Great Britain was completely against that. So coolies, the Chinese, were brought just to replace the African slaves. It was a disguise, you know, they wanted to disguise the existence of slavery. So to pretend to say that the trade was stopped, it was not stopped. It was replaced by the coolies, who weren't slaves, but in the practice they were. So Lam is a very outstanding artist. Preguntas para Wilfredo Lam. ¿Y quién vio a Lipo sentarse añorando sus algas de cantón sobre las ruedas de la ciudad, posado así sobre el muro del malecón y sus madréporas? ¿Y quién presenció el aleteo de una paloma entre los dedos de Mantonica Wilson? ¿Y qué hay en la mirada de aquel taita cuyo cuerpo tapiza la proa de un velero innombrable, sino una lluvia de azahares bajo la cruz del sur? ¿Quién los viera mejor sino tu pulso perfumado por estas islas de coral?
Questions for Wilfredo Lam. And who saw Lipo sitting there, pining for the seaweed of Canton, above the wheels of the city, perched there atop the wall of the Malecón with its stony corals? And who witnessed the fluttering wings of a dove grasped by the fingers of Ma Antonica Wilson? And what's in the gaze of that far-off taita, his body draped over the bow of an unnameable sailboat, a shower of orange blossoms under the Southern Cross? Who but you saw them so clearly, your pulse perfumed by these coral islands?
Siempre decían. Siempre decían. Unos lo llaman Lázaro. Otros lo llaman Babalúayú. Todavía hoy no se sabe por cuál firme misterio unos y otros acuden al rincón, un pueblecito extraño y recoleto cuya maravilla deslumbra a cualquier viajero. Llegan en oleadas silvestres para clamar o darle gracias mientras colocan bajo sus pies leprosos sacos de harina inmensos y vacíos, escobas relucientes, flores moradas como nísperos, cuentas de todos los colores y muletas sin dueño. Siempre oirás que te dicen, unos lo llaman Lázaro, otros lo llaman Babaluaí.
Translated by Pam Carnell. They always used to say, some call him Lazarus, others call him Babaluaye. Even today, for who knows what unflinching reason, both groups journeyed to El Rincón, a strange and quiet little town whose marvelous secrets dazzles every visitor, in surging waves to cry out loud or give him thanks while placing at his leprous feet immense and empty flower sacks, sparkling brooms, flowers that are the purple of sopadillas, beads of every color, and crutches unneeded by their owners. You will always hear them tell you. Some call him Lazarus, others call him Babaluaye.
These next poems, I refer to South Africa at the moment of, the struggle against apartheid. Soliloquio de un colono. Acabo de degollar a un obambo. ¿Qué es un obambo? Un negro. Un animal rabioso. Un monstruo con apenas dos patas y dos ojos inmensos como de Lucifer. Eran como las 6 de la tarde y los dos tropezamos saliendo de la granja frente al jardín de la señora Wolf. Las adelfas de la señora Wolf son tan hermosas. Yo se las riego los domingos cuando sal de compras a Pretoria. Dije que tropezó conmigo y no se disculpó. Alzó la cabeza y no se disculpó. Era un grosero, como todos los negros, un obambo de los infiernos, un terrorista, un depredador, un negro obambo. No me pude contener y fui a buscar la soga y la navaja. Ya estaba de espaldas cuando lo derribé. Eso fue todo, Peter. Yo bien respeto el orden y la ley. Jugamos a las cartas.
Translated by Mirta Quintanales, a planter's soliloquy. I just cut an obambo's throat. What's an obambo? A nigger? A rabid animal? A monster on two legs with two enormous eyes like Lucifer's? It was about 6 in the afternoon, and we bumped into each other leaving the farm in front of Mrs. Wolf's garden. Mrs. Wolf's rose bays are so beautiful. I water them for her on Sundays when she goes out shopping in Pretoria. I said he bumped into me and did not apologize. He raised his head and did not apologize. He was rude like all niggers, an obambo out of hell, a terrorist, a predator, an obambo nigger, and I could not control myself and went to get the rope and the blade. He had already turned his back when I struck him down. That was all, Peter. I greatly respect law and order. Shall we play cards?
Epitafio para una dama de Pretoria, sobre una idea del poeta County Colley, que perteneció a Harlem Renaissance. Siempre pensó que aún resurrecta dormiría la mañana hasta que 3 ángeles negros le hicieran bien la cama y sobre todo el desayuno.
Translated by Mirza Quintanilla. Epitaph for a lady from Pretoria, after an idea from the poet County Cullen. She always thought that even resurrected, she would sleep the morning until 3 black angels made her bed, and above all, her breakfast.
Mirar adentro. Which is the name of this anthology, which is available today. Mirar adentro. del siglo XVI data mi pena, y apenas lo sabía, porque aquel ruiseñor siempre canta en mi pena.
Translated by Heather Rosario Cibe, Looking Within. From the 16th century dates my sorrow, and I hardly knew it, because that nightingale always sings in my sorrow.
Cantares. Desde el cantar de los cantares, muchos quisieron confinar la poesía, pero el cantar de los cantares y el ulular de las jirafas en la jungla la salvaban, la acariciaban, la traían suavemente de la mano hasta depositarla en el segundo más fugaz de hoy. Buscando la verdad, la poesía fue creando la más antigua rancia y vagó sola durante muchos siglos, por los siglos de los siglos, desde el cantar de los cantares. Nadie la pudo contener, ninguno pudo hacerla suya, nadie siquiera logró domesticarla, ninguna la pudo interceptar, solo el pájaro azul de la mañana.
Songs. Ever since the Song of Songs, many have tried to lock poetry away, but the Song of Songs and the ululating of giraffes in the jungle saved her, caressed her, led her gently by the hand, then nestled her in the most fleeting second of today. Searching for the truth, poetry was forging the oldest nomadic path, and she wandered alone for many centuries, century after century, ever since the Song of Songs. No one could hold her back. No man could make her his. No one even found a way to tame her. No woman could waylay her, just the bluebird in the morning.
Paisaje célebre. Ver la caída de Ícaro desde la bahía de azules y verdes de la mar. Un valle al que se asoma un misántropo encapuchado. Árboles frutales alrededor de las aguas y un hombrecillo solo arando sobre ellas hasta incorporarse al arco iris. Ese hombrecillo es un pariente de Brogan el Viejo, hermano mío, que pinta la soledad del alma cercada por espléndidos labradores. Es el atardecer y necesito las alas de Ica.
Translated by Gabrielle Abu, Glorious Landscape. Seeing the fall of Icarus from the blue and gray bay of Alamar, a valley at which a hooded misanthrope makes his appearance, fruit trees surrounding the waters, and a lonely smallish man plowing over them until he joins the rainbow. The smallish man is a relative of the old Bruegel, my dear brother, who paints the loneliness of the heart surrounded by splendid farmers. It is sunset, and I need the wings of Icarus.
Nunca vi grandes lagos. En esta isla que me viera nacer, nunca vi grandes lagos, o breves lagos verdes, o amarillos, o simples lagos límpidos en el centro del valle. Mas cuando silba el huracán, mis ropas se desgajan, y el nudo en la garganta, y el salto que sube hasta los sesos, y el nido de mis gorriones revuelto, húmedo, vacío.
Translated by Gabrielle Abunum. I never saw great lakes. In this island which witnessed my birth, I never saw great lakes, or small green lakes, or yellow ones, or simple crystalline lakes in the middle of the valley. But when the hurricane blows, my clothes are torn off, and the knot in my throat, and the leaf that reaches my brains, and the nests of my sparrows tangled up, wet, empty.
The last two poems are very free, very Caribbean. Así lo cuentan las leyendas, las pisadas del antílope cuando avecina su elegancia alertan al cazador que espera agazapado y trémulo. Así lo cuentan las leyendas, pero y tus pisadas y tu sigilosa aparición, esas me toman por sorpresa, me asaltan para siempre, agazapada como el cazador, trémula como la hoja de hierba, sin palabras precisas, sin lengua, como un bozal del siglo XIX.
Translated by Gabriel Abu, así lo cuentan. The hoofbeats of the antelope as it approaches and its elegance alert the hunter who lies in wait, trembling. So say the legends. But what about your footsteps and your silent appearance? Those take me by surprise. They haunt me forever. Crouching like the hunter, trembling like the leaf of grass, without the right words, speechless, like a 19th century African slave.
Divertimento. Para guitarra. Como le gustaría a Rafael Alberti. Entre la espada y el clavel, amo las utopías. Amo los arcoíris y el papalote, y amo el cantar del peregrino. Amo el romance entre el oso y la iguana. Amo los pasaportes. ¿Cuándo dejarán de existir los pasaportes? Amo los afanes del día y las tabernas y la guitarra en el atardecer. Amo una isla atravesada en la garganta de Goliath como una palma en el centro del golfo. Amo a David. Amo la libertad, que es una siempre viva.
Translated by Heather Rosario Siver. Divertimento, for the pleasure of Rafael Alberti, for guitar. Between the sword and the carnation, I love utopias. I love the rainbow and the kite, and I love the song of the pilgrim. I love the romance between the bear and the iguana. I love passports. When will passports cease to exist? I love daily chores and the taverns and guitars in the evening. I love a thorny island in the throat of Goliath, like a palm tree in the center of the Gulf. I love David. I love liberty, which is an everlasting flower.
Thank you very much.
Nancy, tu poesía suena, well, I guess in English, your poetry is so epic and also so, like, feathery. Would you describe yourself like that? Do you think that you go between that feathery, flying feeling and also that, like, stomping on the floor of history? Like, how do you feel about that?
Thanks for the question. Very interesting and very difficult to answer. I feel myself like a leaf, like a tool for communicating things of my life, which is a very special life in an island with many, many problems, many, many great experiences, epic experiences, I mean, painful passages, and so forth. So I do trust in the power of the word, but I do think also that a poem, the poems come, you have to receive them, to accept them. Then you put them in a drawer, you wait a little while, and then 1 month, 1 day, you come back, and then you profile all your readings, your techniques, because writing is a work, it's a job. I will never forget an interview by a Hungarian poet who was awarded maybe two or three decades ago, who was awarded in the Western world, used to live in Hungary. And he, in that interview, he proposed 10 thinkings, 10 thoughts. One of them was, don't let people tell you that when you are looking at the sunset, you are not working. That's my work. That's my job. To look at the sunset and sometimes be so sincere that you are in trouble, which is the best, because you cannot accept a writing which is not going to accept risk. And that's very important. Anyway, I do trust in inspiration, as I was saying the other day to some pupils here in the Chapel Hill campus. Inspiration exists, but Hemingway used to say, I want inspiration to arrive while I am writing. Which means that you cannot be passive, just waiting for an idea, waiting for a feeling, waiting. No, you have to work and to work, and suddenly there is inspiration, which is very, very important for creative writing. Yes.
I'm wondering, now at this point in your life, your work is very, very much appreciated in Latin America, in the Caribbean, in Europe, and here, in much the same way that Guillen's work was. So do you see yourself in some ways donning that role that he played and bringing together communities that had been separated but were able to come together around his work?
Yes, I think that your question is a compliment.
It is.
It's a compliment. I wrote books on Guillen. Everybody knows 2 or 3 books of essays and research and so on. We were friends, very good friends, although there was a big difference between us in many senses. He respected me. I respected him. And we decided to start a dialogue that never stopped. I learned a lot with him, not exactly for writing poetry, although I always talk about the day that I showed him Black Woman. I was fearful, and he said, after a silence, you wrote an important poem. That was all. And I know that his poetry, his essays, that not everybody know, and that they need to be put together and to be translated. Many essays of the 30s, of the 40s, and even of the 70s. So it's a chapter, an unforgettable chapter in my literary life, that's it. But we are very different. Looking different, and he knew that the little spot that I gave birth through those poems had the gender issue as a very important issue. We discussed about this and so, and he knew his time, I knew mine, but the most important thing is that we worked together. I had the experience of working with him. He worked with me. There was a great respect between each other. And I think that many of my poems wouldn't have existed without those of him. For the gaze of a woman, of course. But it was for me a great master.
Dos preguntas. Una es acerca del monólogo del pescador. Let me just say in English. I have one question about the poem Monólogo del Pescador. Is there a myth or an image behind that poem? What is the inspiration? behind it, because when I heard it, it made me feel, think so many different things. So could you talk a little bit about
that? Yes, thanks for the question. Well, I think that I love that poem a lot. I love it. But it's like the very first goal that I did have of building a character, because he's the fisherman who's talking, not me. You know, the I in poetry is so important. For instance, if you read Leaves of Grass by Walt Whitman, which was one of the very first books of American poetry that I've read, published in Cuba, a little anthology like that, in 1960. And he always talked about I and we. There's a great interaction between the we and I. His gaze towards his country. He was such an epic poet and such a modern poet. So in this case, this poem, the I is not Nancy Morejón. Like in Black Woman also, people sometimes are very confused in that sense. And I will never forget that I was reading in UPR in Puerto Rico many years ago, around 1979, under Carter. It was possible to travel from Havana directly. I traveled from Mexico, Havana, Mexico, and then Puerto Rico. And it was a reading like this one, and I've read Black Woman, and there was a young woman, a young girl there, and she raised a question. She said, did you write that poem more as a woman or more as a black? And I started to look at my body. For me, it was impossible to cut my body into two pieces, woman or black. And I told her, very spontaneously, I told her, I wrote it like Nancy Morejón, a human being who has traditions, has ancestors, and wants to know about history. But that I is not me. It's not a biographical I. It's an epic one, which is, there's a great difference. So in the case of the fisherman, I'm not a fisherman, of course. I have never fished. But in modern times, you know, gender is so challenging. So I took my voice for the voice of the fisherman, and the fisherman is talking. Okay? So he's expressing himself. But I've been very, very, I have no skill for writing a novel or writing a short story. I don't know why. For the moment, you know, I'm 73 years old, and for me it's very easy, the poetry writing, it's very, no problem. But fiction, you know, is very, very difficult. So that poem really wanted to be something else. It was like a character talking in a playwright. I never wrote playwrights either. But that's the characteristic of that poem that I love a lot. I love it. Yes.
I would like to ask the last question. So you talk about epic books and the long life you've lived and all the experiences you've had, and that Black Woman is not true, not autobiographical. When will you be writing a memoir?
Very soon.
With all of those wonderful stories that you've had,
yes. Very soon, I think I need, because sometimes I'm. Thanks for the question, Corina, because I realize there are many things that I have lived, which are important, because when I talk about them, having coffee or you know, eating or whatever, I realize that the people who are around me. That's her interest. No, we didn't know this and that. And so, actually, I am still able to write, to have a memory of many things. Later on, I won't.
your memory is a steel trap.
That's it. So I have to take advantage to take profit about it and try to write. It's a project I have. But sometimes life is very tricky because you have to leave yourself for your rememberings and things, and I cannot remember because I have to go out and go to a meeting or go to make a translation, and then you have to stop and go, and then it's over. I have to have the willing of good willing of staying and doing it, or I don't know what I'm going to do, but I need to do it because maybe next year I won't be the same person, and my memory will be weak. So now is the time to do it. Yes.
So would you like to maybe people with people?
Whatever. I appreciate your presence here.